very good morning. I, Priya Pujari, Faculty Associate at Manipal Center for European Studies, welcome you all to m.i.l.a.p 2019 and sincerely hope that you have a wonderful time with us in the next 2 days to come. As we kickstart the literary meet, I will take a few minutes to introduce the very first panel of the day. A revered actor, a legendary writer, an exemplary director, and a pioneer playwright. Indeed, one falls short of words to describe Sri Girish Karnad and his monumental legacy to the literary world. Be it Yayati, his debut play, or Tughlaq, Karnad, with his unique theatrical craft, wielding historical and mythological narration to depict and explore the contemporary social realities, quintessentially portrays him at the forefront of Indian theater. His rigorous pursuit of finding meaning in the twilight of modernity by re-examination of the history mirrors the tumultuous transformations that we experience in the new age of digitization. m.i.l.a.p 2019 attempts to pay tribute to Karnad and his artistic legacy by carefully reflecting over his journey and his contributions with the very first panel of the day, which is titled Girish Karnad, Memories and Modernity. And for this, I would like to invite the distinguished panelists, Mr. Amrit Gangar, Dr. Kamlakar Bhatt, Mr. Prakash Belawadi, Professor T P Ashoka, along with the moderator, Ms. Maitri Karnur. May I please invite them to take their place on the stage. Thank you very much. Before we begin, I'd like to take a minute to introduce our moderator, Ms. Maitri Karnur. Maitri Karnur is a poet, critic, and a literary translator. In 2019, A Handful of Sesame, her English translation of the award-winning Kannada novel, Halla Bantu Halla, was shortlisted for the Lucian Strick Asian Translation Prize. Her works have been appeared in the Wire, The Hindu, Daily O, Indian Literature, and Muse India. She was shortlisted for the Montreal International Poetry Prize in 2017. She also writes a social satire comic strip blog known as The Drawer Avatar. And now I would leave the task of introducing our panelists to Ms. Maitri.
That's a bit of a dated introduction. I wish you hadn't mentioned the blog there. I haven't been updating in a very long time. But in place of that, these days I do recitations of my translations of poetry, and I put it up on SoundCloud. Maybe if you're interested, you can look that up. That idea was given to me by my friend Arvind Bhatt, who's there in the audience. Thank you. I don't think we need much of an introduction to Girish Karnad or his works. As a playwright, actor, director, Rhodes scholar, Jnanapith winner, polyglot writer, the hats he wore were many and grand. And be it political, social, or environmental, he remained vociferous about his convictions till the very end. Even when his voice was weak with age and illness, he turned up at protests and events, and images of him, you know, holding up placards with his breathing apparatus in place have gained somewhat of an iconic status now. Girish Karnad passed away earlier this year, and the world of literature, theater, and cinema is left poorer by his passing. Today in m.i.l.a.p, I am in conversation with four personalities who have engaged closely with his works, and it is through their words in this panel titled Girish Karnad, Memories and Modernity that we seek to honor his memory and to decipher the meaning and scope of the term modernity. We have with us Prakash Belawadi, who's a theater, film, television, and media personality. Prakash co-founded the Center for Film and Drama and launched the Suchitra School of Cinema and Dramatic Arts. Apart from acting in Kannada, Hindi, Tamil, Malayalam, and Telugu films, he's also the director of the film Stumble, for which he received the National Film Award in 2002. He has also received the Karnataka Nataka Academy Award in 2012 for his contribution to English and Kannada language theater. Most recently, he has directed one of Girish Karnad's later plays, Boiled Beans on Toast, and I look forward to talking to him about it in a while. We also have Amrit Gangar, who is a Mumbai-based author, film theorist, historian and curator. He has authored and co-authored several publications in English and Gujarati. He has curated a number of retrospective programs for the Mumbai International Film Festival for documentary, short and animation films, as also festivals and gallery shows in Europe and elsewhere. He has been on several festival juries. As the founder director of Data Kino, he has helped set up a comprehensive database for the film's division's collection of over 9,000 documentaries and short films. He's the recipient of awards and recognitions from the University of Mumbai, Naval Dockyard Mumbai, Cinematographers Combine, the International Federation of Film Clubs, etc. Amrit Gangar has developed a new concept called Cinema of Prayoga that aims at substituting and expanding the generally accepted Euro-American-centric term, the experimental film. We are hoping we'll talk about that a little in a while. We have Professor T P Ashoka, who's a well-known critique and scholar in Kannada. He has been teaching literature, theatre and film for the last 40 years. Apart from teaching in an autonomous college, he has organized and taught in more than 350 short-term workshops all over Karnataka. He's also a columnist and a translator. He has authored more than 30 books, which include collections of critical essays, monographs, and full-length studies of eminent Kannada writers such as Kuvempu, Masti Venkatesh Iyengar, Shivaram Karant, Tejasvi, Vaidehi, and others. He has also worked as a member of the language advisory panels in institutions such as the Bharatiya Jnanpeeth, Birla Foundation, Kendra Sahitya Academy, and National Book Trust of India. He's received the Karnataka Sahitya Academy Award, Masti Award, and most recently in 2017, he has received the Kendra Sahitya Academy Award for his book of literary criticism called Kathana Bharati that was published by MUP. We also have Dr. Kamalakar Bhatt. He was introduced earlier this morning, but I'll introduce him again for the benefit of those who walked in just now. Kamalakar Bhatt was born in Sirsi and had his education in Sirsi, Mysore and Pune. He's presently an associate professor at the Postgraduate Department of English in Ahmednagar, Maharashtra. He's a bilingual writer and a translator between Kannada, English, Hindi and Marathi. His publications include three collections of poems in Kannada. The first, Churu Paru Reshme, published in 2006, won the Putina Award for Best Book. The second, Mugiyada Madhyana, was published in 2010. His third collection, Jagada Jote Matukate, was published in 2017. He has translated into English the poetry of several contemporary Kannada poets. He has also translated into English the works of the Marathi Dalit poet Namdev Dhasal and published a reader on him in Kannada, which was brought out by Kuvempu Bhasha Bharati. He has translated a few prose works of Tejasvi and Ashok Hegde. He's presently translating into English poems of 100 contemporary Kannada poets for an anthology. His academic work is in the field of literary theory, Indian literatures, and comparative literature. A collection of H.S. Shivaprakash's essays and lectures that he edited titled The Word in the World has been published by MUP and was released this morning. So to begin with, I have a question for Professor T.P. Ashoka. In your collection Kathana Bharati, you have written about Girish Karnad's short stories. And Girish Karnad is known as a playwright, not so much as a short story writer. So I'm interested to know how you chose these two stories. I believe these are the only two short stories he's written. One is Alida Mele and the other one is Musliman Banda Musliman. So I would like to understand how you chose these works.
ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಕಥೆಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತನಾಡೋಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮೊದಲು ನಾನು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕನ ಒಟ್ಟು ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಪರಂಪರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕೆ ನೋಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ನಾಟಕಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕೂಡ ನಾನು ಬರೆದಿದ್ದೀನಿ, ಆದರೆ ಇವತ್ತು ನಾನು ಫೋಕಸ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡಿರೋದು ಹೇಗೆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕರು ಒಬ್ಬ ಅಪ್ಪಟ ಕನ್ನಡ ಮನುಷ್ಯ ಆಗಿದ್ದ, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಪರಂಪರೆಯ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಎಂಥ ಒಂದು ಅನುಸಂಧಾನ ಇತ್ತು ಮತ್ತು ಅವರ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಕೃತಿಗಳು ಈ ಅನುಸಂಧಾನದ ಫಲ ಆಗಿದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು. ಭಾಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರಿಗೆ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷಿನ ಕವಿ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಭಾಳ ಆಸೆ ಇತ್ತಂತೆ. ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾವ್ಯ ಬರೆದು ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಸೆಟ್ಲ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವರು ಧಾರವಾಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಓದ್ತಾ ಇರಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ತಯಾರಿಗಳನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಆದರೆ ಅವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಕವಿ ಆಗಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಕನ್ನಡದ ನಾಟಕಕಾರರಾದರು. ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ ಅಟ್ ದಿ ಔಟ್ಸೆಟ್ ಯುನೋ ಹೀ ಅಪಿಯರ್ಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ವೆರಿ ವೆಸ್ಟ್ರನ್ ಆಂಗ್ಲಿಸೈಸ್ಡ್ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ, ಅವರ ಹೊರರೂಪ ಹೇಗಿದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಅಪ್ಪಟ ಕನ್ನಡ ಮನುಷ್ಯ. ಒಂದು ಇನ್ಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ ಭಾಳ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ. ಅವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡಿಂದ ಬಂದ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗಲೇ ಯಯಾತಿ ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂದಿತ್ತು. ಸತ್ಯದೇವ ದುಬೆ ಮರಾಠಿ ನಿರ್ದೇಶಕ, ನಮ್ಮ ಬಿ ವಿ ಕಾರಂತರಷ್ಟೇ ದೊಡ್ಡ ನಿರ್ದೇಶಕರು, ಅವರನ್ನು ಭೇಟಿ ಮಾಡಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ಸತ್ಯದೇವ ದುಬೆ ಇವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷಲ್ಲಿ ನಾಟಕ ಬರೀತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಇವ್ರನ್ನ ಅತ್ಯಂತ ತಿರಸ್ಕಾರದಿಂದ ನೋಡಿದ್ರು ಅಂತ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಯಿತು. ಹಾಗೆ ಅವರ ಹೊರ ರೂಪದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿತ್ವ ಇದ್ದೇ ಇತ್ತು ಅಂತ. ಅವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡಿಗೆ ಹೋಗೋ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಯಯಾತಿ ನಾಟಕ ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಯಯಾತಿ ನಾಟಕನ ಜಿ ಬಿ ಜೋಶಿಗೆ ತೋರಿಸಿದ್ರೆ ಜಿ ಬಿ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಮಾತಾಡೋರಲ್ಲ, ಆದರೆ ಒಂದು ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಸಾಕು, ಅದು ಭಾಳ ಅರ್ಥಗರ್ಭಿತವಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಜೋಶಿ ಅವರು ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತು. ಅವರು ಆ ನಾಟಕದ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಡೈಲಾಗನ್ನು ಕೋಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಈ ಡೈಲಾಗ್ ಭಾಳ ಚಂದದ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರು ಅಂತೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ಇದೊಂದು ಬಿಟ್ಟಿನ ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೂ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತದಲ್ಲ. ಆಗ ಇವರಿಗೆ ಇನ್ನಷ್ಟು ಭಾಳ ಬೇಜಾರಾಗಿ ಇನ್ನು ಕನ್ನಡದ ಪರಲು ಹರಿಯಿತು, ನಾನು ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡಲ್ಲೇ ಸೆಟ್ಲಾಗಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಪೋಯೆಟ್ ಆಗ್ತೀನಿ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ವರ್ಷ ಆದಮೇಲೆ ಅವರ ಅನುಭವಗಳೆಲ್ಲ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅಷ್ಟೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಕುರ್ತಕೋಟಿಯವರು ಯಯಾತಿ ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಟನ್ನು ಓದಿ ಅನೇಕ ಸಲಹೆ ಸೂಚನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಅದನ್ನು ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇವರು ನಾಟಕವನ್ನು ತಿದ್ದು ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಮನೋಹರ್ ಗಂತಮಾಲದಿಂದ ಪಬ್ಲಿಷ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಕನ್ನಡ ಕ್ರಿಟಿಕಲ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಭಾಳ ಉತ್ಸಾಹದಿಂದ ರೆಸ್ಪಾಂಡ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ. ಅದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಓದಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರಿಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲ, ನನ್ನ ಜಗಳ, ನನ್ನ ಸಂತೋಷ, ನನ್ನ ವಾಗ್ವಾದ ಏನಿದ್ರೂ ನನ್ನ ಕನ್ನಡದ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಹೊರತು ನಾನು ಈ ಇಂಗ್ಲೆಂಡಲ್ಲಿ ಬದುಕೋದಕ್ಕೂ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷಲ್ಲಿ ಕವಿ ಆಗೋದಕ್ಕೂ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಅವರು ಕನ್ನಡದ ನಾಟಕಕಾರರಾಗ್ತಾರೆ. ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರು ಮೊದಲಿಂದ ಅವ್ರು ನೋಡಿ ಸಿರ್ಸಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಓದಿದ್ದು, ಭಾಳ ರೀಜನಲ್ ಆದ ಮನುಷ್ಯ. ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಒಂದು ಕಾಸ್ಮೋಪಾಲಿಟನ್ ಮುಖ ಇದ್ದರೂ ಕೂಡ ಆ ಮುಖ ವಾಡದ ಒಳಗೆ ಭಾಳ ಅಪ್ಪಟ ದೇಶಿ ಮನುಷ್ಯ. ಅವರು ಯಕ್ಷಗಾನ ನೋಡಿ, ಕಂಪನಿ ನಾಟಕಗಳನ್ನ ನೋಡಿ, ಕಾವ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಓದಿ, ಕಥೆಗಳನ್ನು ಓದಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಸಂವೇದನೆಯನ್ನು ರೂಪಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡವರು. ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಎಂಥ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮವಾದ ಮನುಷ್ಯ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಗೋಕಾಕರ ಪಟ್ಟ ಶಿಷ್ಯರು ಇವರು. ಗೋಕಾಕರಿಂದ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗು ತೊಗೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಮುಂದೆ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಪೋಯಿಟ್ ಆಗೋಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಭಾಳ ಬೇಗ ಗೋಕಾಕ್ ಅಂಥ ಮಹತ್ವದ ಕವಿ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ನಿಸ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ, ಬೇಂದ್ರೆ ರಾಮಾನುಜನ್ ಕಂಬಾರರಿಗೆ ಹೋಲಿಸಿದ್ರೆ ಅಂತ. ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರು ಹಳೆಗನ್ನಡ ಮತ್ತು ಹೊಸಗನ್ನಡ ಎರಡೂ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಪರಂಪರೆಯ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸಂಬಂಧ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡವರು. ಮತ್ತು ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರ ಒಟ್ಟು ಬರವಣಿಗೆ ಮತ್ತು ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿತ್ವದಲ್ಲೇ ಈ ಎರಡು ಮೂರು ಅಂಶಗಳು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ, ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯದ ಓದುಗರಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತು ವಿಮರ್ಶಕರಾಗಿ. ಈಗ ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ವಚನ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯದ ಅವರ ಅನುಸಂಧಾನ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಅದರ ಒಂದು ಉಪಫಲವಾಗಿ ತಲೆದಂಡ ನಾಟಕ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಯಶೋಧರ ಚರಿತೆ ಜನ್ನಂದು ಅದರ ಜೊತೆಗಿನ ಒಂದು ಅನುಸಂಧಾನ ಮತ್ತು ಆಳವಾದ ಓದಿನ ಫಲವಾಗಿ ಹಿಟ್ಟಿನ ಹುಂಜ ಇದು ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಅದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದು ಅದ್ಭುತವಾದ ಲೇಖನವನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಅವರು ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಕನ್ನಡ ನಾಟಕಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ವಿಶ್ಲೇಷಣಾತ್ಮಕ ಬರಹಗಳನ್ನು ಬರೆದವರು ಬಹಳ ಕಡಿಮೆ. ಆ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರು ಶ್ರೀರಂಗರ ಹರಿಜನ್ವಾರ ಮತ್ತು ಮಾಸ್ತಿಯವರ ಕಾಕನಕೋಟೆ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬರೆದ ವಿಶ್ಲೇಷಣಾತ್ಮಕ ಪ್ರಬಂಧಗಳಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಕನ್ನಡ ನಾಟಕ ವಿಮರ್ಶೆಯ ಇತಿಹಾಸದಲ್ಲೇ ಒಂದು ಮೈಲಿಗಲ್ಲು ಅಂತ ನನಗೆ ಅನಿಸುತ್ತೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಅವರು ಕಾಡು, ಆಲ್ನಳ್ಳಿ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರ ಕಾಡು ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ನೋಟ್ ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಹೇಗೆ ಆ ಕಾಡು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒಬ್ಬ ಬಾಲಕನಿಗೆ ಇಡೀ ವಯಸ್ಕರ ಜಗತ್ತೇ ಒಂದು ಕಾಡು ಹಂಗೆ ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ದಿ ಜಂಗಲ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಸಿಂಬಾಲಿಕ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಹೋಲ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಡಲ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಅದನ್ನು ಅವರು ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವರ ಸಿನಿಮಾದ ಚರಿತ್ರೆ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೂ ಕೂಡ ಕಾಡು, ವಂಶವೃಕ್ಷ, ತಬ್ಬಲಿಯು ನೀನಾದೆ ಮಗನೇ, ಕಾನೂರು ಹೆಗ್ಗಿಡತಿ, ಹೀಗೆ ಅವರು ಉದ್ದಕ್ಕೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಕನ್ನಡದ ಕೃತಿಗಳ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ರೀತಿಯ ಪ್ರಯೋಗಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬಂದಿದ್ದರು. ಬಹಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರದ ಅವರು ಓದು. ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಓದಿದಾಗ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕರು ತಮ್ಮ ಆತ್ಮಚರಿತ್ರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬರ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ, ಅವರಿಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಹೊಟ್ಟೆ ಕಿಚ್ಚಾಗ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ಅಯ್ಯೋ, ಈ ಕಾದಂಬರಿಯನ್ನು ನಾನು ಬರೀಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು, ಈ ಅನಂತಮೂರ್ತಿ ಬರೆದು ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದಾರಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಎಷ್ಟವ್ರನ್ನ ಆವರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿತ್ತು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರದ ಸಿನಿಮಾದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಪ್ರಾಣೇಶಾಚಾರ್ಯನ ಪಾತ್ರವನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿ ನಾನು ಆ ಋಣಭಾರವನ್ನು ಕಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕಾಯಿತು ಅನ್ನೋ ಮಾತನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರು ವಿಮರ್ಶೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಗೆ ಬರೀದೇ ಹೋದರು ಕೂಡ ಅವರು ಬರೆದಿರೋದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಕೊಡುವ ಇನ್ಸೈಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಭಾಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್. ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್, ಚಿಕ್ಕವೀರ ರಾಜೇಂದ್ರ ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ರಾಮಚಂದ್ರ ಶರ್ಮಾ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದು ಪುಟದ ಮುನ್ನುಡಿ ಇದೆ ಅದು. ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ದಿ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಈವಿಲ್ ಇನ್ ಚಿಕ್ಕವೀರ ರಾಜೇಂದ್ರದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕರು ಹೇಳಿರೋ ಮಾತಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಬಹಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಅದು. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಬೇಂದ್ರೆ ಸಾಕ್ಷ್ಯಚಿತ್ರ ಕೂಡ ಅದು. ಅಂದರೆ ಅವರು ಒಬ್ಬ ವಿಮರ್ಶಕರಾಗಿದ್ದ ಬೇಂದ್ರೆ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದು ಪುಸ್ತಕನೇ ಬರಿಬೋದಾಗಿತ್ತು, ಅದ್ರ ಬದಲು ಆ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಇದು ಓನ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ ಕೂಡ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡನ್ ದಟ್ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಅಂತ ಅನಿಸುತ್ತೆ. ಈ ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕಥೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಬಂದರೆ, ಅವರ ಮೊದಲ ಕಥೆ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು, ಅದು ಖ್ಯಾತ ಕನ್ನಡ ಕಾದಂಬರಿಕಾರ ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತರ ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಾದಂಬರಿಗೆ ಕಾರಂತರ ಸೃಜನಶೀಲ ಪ್ರತಿಕ್ರಿಯೆ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರತಿಸ್ಪಂದನೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು ನಾವು. ಅಂದರೆ ಅವರು ಅದು ಹಳೆಗನ್ನಡ ಕಾವ್ಯಗಳಾಗಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ಹೊಸಗನ್ನಡ ಕೃತಿಗಳಾಗಲಿ ಅವರನ್ನು ಎಷ್ಟು ಆವರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿತ್ತು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಮತ್ತು ಅವುಗಳ ಒಂದು ಬೈ ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟಾಗೇ ನಾನು ಇದನ್ನು ನೋಡೋದು ಅಂತ. ಈಗ ನನಗೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು 2-3 ನಿಮಿಷ ಟೈಮ್ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಈ ಕಥೆಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಸಂಕ್ಷಿಪ್ತವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿಬಿಡ್ತೇನೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ಅವರು ಕಥೆಗಾರರಾಗಿ ಅಷ್ಟು ಪ್ರಸಿದ್ಧರಾಗಿಲ್ಲದೆ ಇರೋದರಿಂದ ಮತ್ತು ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಜನ ಆ ಕಥೆಗಳನ್ನು ಓದಿಲ್ಲದೆ ಇರೋದರಿಂದ ಸಂಕ್ಷಿಪ್ತವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಒಂದೊಂದು ನಿಮಿಷದಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ಕಥೆಗಳನ್ನು ಹೇಳಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತೇನೆ. ಈ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಹಿನ್ನೆಲೆ ಇದೆ. 1990 ತಲೆದಂಡ ನಾಟಕ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, 1998 ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಥೆ ಬರೆದಿದ್ದು, ಮತ್ತು ಈ 90ರ ದಶಕ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಭಾರತದ ಒಟ್ಟು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದ ದಶಕ ಅದು. ಅಂದರೆ 70ರಲ್ಲಿ ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ಆದ ನಂತರ ಈ ಮಂದಿರ ಮತ್ತು ಮಸೀದಿಯ ಈ ಸಂಘರ್ಷ ಏನಿದೆ, ಆ ಸಂಘರ್ಷದ ಆ ದಶಕ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರಿಗೆ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಮತ್ತು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವರು ಭಾಳ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ರೀತಿ ರೆಸ್ಪಾಂಡ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ತಲೆದಂಡ ಕೂಡ ಆ ಥರದ ಒಂದು ರೆಸ್ಪಾನ್ಸ್ ಅದು. ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ನೋಡಿ, ಆ ಕಥೆಯ ವೈಶಿಷ್ಟ್ಯ ಏನು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಈ ನಿಜ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಗಳ ನಾಮಧೇಯಗಳನ್ನು ಹಾಗೆ ಬಳಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಈ ಕಥೆಯ ಉತ್ತಮ ಪುರುಷ ನಿರೂಪಕ ಗಿರೀಶ್ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡೆ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತ ಅಂತಲೇ ಹೆಸರು ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಲಾಲು ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ಯಾದವ್ ಅಂತ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಅನಂತ್ ನಾಗ್ ಅಂತ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ರಿಜ್ವಿ ಅಂತ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಒಂದಿನ ಈ ರಿಜ್ವಿ ಅನ್ನುವ ಫಿಲ್ಮ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರು ಈ ಕಥೆಯ ನಿರೂಪಕನಾದ ಗಿರೀಶನ್ನು ಮೀಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ನಾನೊಂದು ಡಿಟೆಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ, ನೀವು ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತೆಲ್ಲ ಕೇಳಿ, ಆದರೆ ನಿಜವಾಗಿ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಭೇಟಿ ಮಾಡಿದ ಉದ್ದೇಶ ಏನಂದರೆ, ನಾನು ಈಚೆಗೆ ಒಂದು ಕನ್ನಡ ಕಾದಂಬರಿಯ ಉರ್ದು ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್ ಓದಿದೆ. ಆ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲೇಷನ್ ಬಹಳ ನನ್ನ ಮೇಲೆ ಪರಿಣಾಮ ಬೀರಿತು ಅಂತ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ. ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಹೋದಾಗ ಅದು ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಗಿರೀಶರಿಗೆ ಅನಿಸುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ರಿಜ್ವಿಗೆ ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಾದಂಬರಿ ಯಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹಳ ಇಷ್ಟ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಅಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಅದರ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಆ ಕಾದಂಬರಿಯ ನಿರೂಪಕನಾದ ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತ, ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಪಾತ್ರವಾದ ಯಶವಂತ ರಾವ್, ಅವರಿಬ್ಬರೂ ನಾಸ್ತಿಕರು, ಇವರಿಬ್ಬರೂ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸು. ಯಶವಂತ ರಾವ್ ತೀರ್ಕೊಂಡ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದು ವಿಲ್ ಬರೆದು ಆ ವಿಲ್ಲನ್ನು ಎಕ್ಸಿಕ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ತಮ್ಮ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತ, ದಿ ನೆರೇಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ನಾವೆಲ್, ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಅದರ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಏನು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಒಂದು ಹಳ್ಳಿನಲ್ಲಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಒಬ್ಬ ಅಜ್ಜಿಯ ಆಸೆಯನ್ನು ತೀರಿಸೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿಯ ಪಾಳು ಬಿದ್ದ ಗುಡಿಯ ಜೀರ್ಣೋದ್ಧಾರ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಅದು ರಿಜ್ವಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾನೆ, ಇದು ನೋಡಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಸ್ಪಿರಿಚುವಲ್ ಜಾಗೃತಿಯ ಸಿಂಬಲ್ ಮಂದಿರದ ಪುನರ್ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಅದು ಎಷ್ಟು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿದೆ. ಇಬ್ಬರೂ ನಾಸ್ತಿಕರು, ಆದರೆ ಆ ಅಜ್ಜಿಯ ಶ್ರದ್ಧೆಯನ್ನು ಗೌರವಿಸಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂದ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಹೇಳ್ತಾನೆ ತಾನು ಏನೇನು ಹೆಂಗೆ ವಿಜುವಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಅಂತ ಕೊನೆಯ ಸೀನ್ ಇದು. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಂದಿರದ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಆ ಹಿಂದೆ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ಇಬ್ಬರು ಅಜ್ಜಿಯರು ವೈರಿಯರಾಗಿದ್ದು ಈಗ ಅಪ್ಪಿಕೊಂಡು ಕಣ್ಣೀರು ಸುರಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತರ, ಅದು ನಿಮಗೂ ಒಂದು ಸಾರ್ಥಕ್ಯದ ಕ್ಷಣ. ನೀವು ಒಮ್ಮೆ ಹಿಂತಿರುಗಿ ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಕಣ್ಣಲ್ಲೂ ನೀರು ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಲಾಜವಾಬು ಈ ಸನ್ನಿವೇಶ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ನೀವು ಶಿವರಾಮ್ ಕಾರಂತರ ಪಾತ್ರ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಅನಂತನಾಗು ಯಶವಂತ ರಾವ್ ಪಾತ್ರ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾತಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ತಾನೆ. ಬಟ್ ಸಬ್ಸಿಕ್ವೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಹಿ ಡೈಸ್. ಅಷ್ಟೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಈ ಸಲಾಗಿಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲ ಆಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅವನ ಮಕ್ಕಳೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂದು ಇವ್ರು ಗಿರೀಶ್ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ರಿಗೆ, ಇಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಇದನ್ನು ಚಿತ್ರನ ಪೂರ್ಣಗೊಳಿಸ್ಕೊಡ್ಬೇಕು, ಸಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಿಕ್ಕಾಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ, ಅಕ್ಕನ ಮದುವೆ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ನೀವು ಏನಾದರೂ ಮಾಡಿ ಇದನ್ನು ತೀರಿಸ್ಬೇಕು. ಆದರೆ ಅಷ್ಟೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಏನಾಗಿದೆ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಾಬ್ರಿ ಮಸೀದಿಯ ಧ್ವಂಸ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಈ ಬಾಬ್ರಿ ಮಸೀದಿಯ ಧ್ವಂಸ ಎಂಥ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮ ಜೀವಿಗಳನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಆಘಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಒಳಪಡಿಸ್ತು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ನಾವು ನೋಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಆ ಥರದ ಆಘಾತಕ್ಕೆ ಈ ಗಿರೀಶನು ಒಳಗಾಗ್ತಾನೆ. ಅವನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾನೆ, ಇಲ್ಲ ನಾನು ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಸರಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಈಗ. ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಈಗ ನಾನು ಆ ಮಂದಿರ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣದ ಸಿನಿಮಾ ಏನಾದರೂ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಈ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇರೆ ಅರ್ಥಗಳು ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ಹಿ ರೆಫ್ಯೂಸಸ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ದಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್. ಯಾಕೆಂದರೆ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲಿ ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಅಂದರೆ ಈ ಕಥೆ ಏನನ್ನು ಸೂಚಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಈ ಅದು ಬರೀ ಈ ಒಟ್ಟು ಕಾಲಮಾನವೇ ಹೇಗಿದೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಅದು ಬರೀ ಮಸೀದಿನ ಧ್ವಂಸ ಮಾಡಲಿಲ್ಲ, ನಮ್ಮ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮತೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಮಾನವೀಯತೆಗಳನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಧ್ವಂಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಂತ. ತಾನು ಮಾಡಬಹುದಾದ ಒಂದು ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಟನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಮಾಡದೇ ಇರೋ ಹಾಗೆ ಈ ಸಂದರ್ಭ ಈ ಕಥೆಯ ಗಿರೀಶನನ್ನು ಇದು ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಅಂದರೆ ಈ ಕಥೆಯ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ನರೇಟರ್ ತನ್ನನ್ನೇ ತಾನು ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮಟೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಈ ಕಾಲದ ಈ ಸಂಕಷ್ಟಗಳಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ ಅದನ್ನು ಬಹಳ ಅದ್ಭುತವಾಗಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಅದು ನನಗೆ ಬಹಳ ಇದಾಯಿತು. ಅಂದರೆ ನಾನು ಅದನ್ನು ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಸಿ ಆಬ್ವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ತಲೆದಂಡ ಈಸ್ ಯುನೋ ಫಾರ್ ಫಾರ್ ಗ್ರೇಟರ್ ಏನೋ ವರ್ಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಆರ್ಟ್ ಅದು ಅಲ್ಲ. ಆದರೆ ಇವರಿಗೆ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರಿಗೆ ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಥೆ ಬರೆಯೋದು ಕಡಿಮೆ ಅಲ್ಲ, ತಲೆದಂಡ ನಾಟಕ ಬರೆಯೋದು ಹೆಚ್ಚಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನೋದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಈ ಮಾತನ್ನು ಹೇಳಬೇಕಾಯಿತು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಮುಸಲ್ಮಾನ ಬಂದ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು 2000 ಇದರಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅದು ಬಹಳ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಂದರೆ, ಹಿತೇಂದ್ರ ಅಂತ ಒಬ್ಬ ಹುಡುಗ, ಅವನಿಗೆ ಯಾವ ಕೆಲಸನೂ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿಲ್ಲ, ಯಾರೂ ಅವನನ್ನು ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಲ್ಲ, ನೋಡೋಕ್ಕೂ ಭಾಳ ಸಣ್ಣವನಾಗಿರ್ತಾನೆ. ಒಂದ್ಸಲಿ ಅಂತೂ ಏನೋ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ತೊಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಮ್ಯಾಚೋ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟಿ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹಾಸ್ಯಾಸ್ಪದನಾಗಿರ್ತಾನೆ. ಕೊನೆಗೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಊರಲ್ಲಿ ಏನೂ ಆಗಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹುಬ್ಳಿಗೆ ಬರ್ತಾನೆ. ಹುಬ್ಳಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾರಸ್ವತರ ಒಂದು ಚಾಳು, ಅಲ್ಲೂ ಕೂಡ ಏನಾಗಲ್ಲ, ಯಾರ್ದೋ ಪತ್ರ ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು, ಇನ್ಯಾರ್ದು ಮನೆ ಅನುಡ್ತನ್ನು ಕೊಡೋದು, ಕಿರಾಣಿ ಅಂಗಡಿಗೆ ಹೋಗೋದು, ಹೀಗೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾನೆ. ಆದರೆ ಅವನ ಜೀವನದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಮಹತ್ತರವಾದ ಘಟನೆ ಯಾವಾಗ ಸಂಭವಿಸುತ್ತೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಅವನ ಗೆಳೆಯ ಅವನನ್ನು ಸಂಘದ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆ ಕರ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದಾನೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡ್ತಾನೆ ಅವನು, ಅವರು ಈ ಹಿಂದೂ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯ ಪುನರುದ್ಧಾರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಲಾಠಿ ವರ್ಷ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವನು ಒಂದು 2 ದಿನ ಕಳೆದು ಕೂಡಲೇ ತನಗೊಂದು ಹೊಸ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಟಿ ಬಂತು. ನಾನು ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾದ ಹುಡುಗ ಅಲ್ಲ, ನನ್ನಿಂದ ಈ ಹಿಂದೂ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯ ರಕ್ಷಣೆ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವ ಒಂದು ಹೊಸ ಇದನ್ನು ಬೆಳೆಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾನೆ. ಹೀಗಿರಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಒಂದಿನ ಅವರ ಗುರುಜಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ, ಈಗೆಲ್ಲ ಬೇಕಾದಷ್ಟು ಕಮ್ಯುನಲ್ ಕ್ಲಾಶಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ನನಗೊಂದು ಸುದ್ದಿ ಬಂದಿದೆ, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಚಾಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಮುಸಲ್ಮಾನರಿಂದ ಗಲಾಟೆ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು, ನಿನ್ನ ಜವಾಬ್ದಾರಿ ಇದು, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಚಾಳನ್ನು ರಕ್ಷಿಸ್ಕೋಬೇಕು ಅಂತ. ಅವತ್ತಿಂದ ಇವನು ಬಹಳ ಸೀರಿಯಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಗಲಾಟೆ ಗೀಟಿ ಹಿಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಧ್ಯರಾತ್ರಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಓಡಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡೋದು. ಒಂದಿನ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಅವನು ಮಧ್ಯರಾತ್ರಿ ಕತ್ತಲಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಲಾಠಿ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ತೂಕಡಿಸ್ತಾ ಇರಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಯಾರೋ ಅವನ ಮೇಲೆ ಬಿದ್ದಾಗತ್ತೆ, ಕೈಗೆ ಒಂದು ಬೋಳು ತಲೆ ಸಿಗುತ್ತೆ. ಇವನು ಮೊದಲು ಇದು ಯಾರೋ ಸಾಬರು ಬೋಳು ತಲೆನೇ ಇರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇವರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಚಾಳನ್ನ ಹಿಂದೂಗಳನ್ನು ರಕ್ಷಿಸಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದರೆ, ಒಂದು ನಿಮಿಷದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಹೆಂಗಸಿನ ಧ್ವನಿ ಕೇಳುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ತಲೆ ಯಾರ್ದು ಅಂದರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಅಂಬುಜಕ್ಕ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಮಡಿ ಹೆಂಗಸು, ಅವಳು ಒಂದು ಬಾಯಿಗೆ ಬಂದಂಗೆ ಬೈತಾಳೆ. ಅವಳು ಪಾಯ್ಕಾನೆಗೆ ಹೋಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಇದನ್ನು ಹಿಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದರೆ ಒಂದು ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಹೋಗೋಕ್ಕೂ ಬಿಡುವಲ್ಲರು, ನೀ ಏನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ, ಮುಸಲ್ಮಾನ ಯಾಕಿಲ್ಲಿ ಬರ್ತಾನೆ ಶಗಣಿ ತಿನ್ನೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂದ್ಕೊಂಡು ಸಮ ಬೈದು, ಇವನು ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಹಾಸ್ಯಾಸ್ಪದ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಹೀ ಇಸ್ ಕ್ರಸ್ಟ್ ಫಾಲ್, ಇವ್ ತನ್ನಿಂದ ಎಂಥ ಒಂದು ಕೆಲಸ ಆಗಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಅವನು ಈ ಇಡೀ ಘಟನೆಯನ್ನು ತನಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ಹಾಗೆ ರೀಕನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳೋಕೆ ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾನೆ. ಇಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಅವತ್ತು ಸಾವಿರೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂದಿದ್ರು, ಅದು ತಪ್ಪಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ನನಗೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದ್ದು ಅದೇನೆ. ಆದರೆ ಅಷ್ಟೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಈ ಅಂಬುಜಕ್ಕ ಬಂದು ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೆಲಸ ಹಾಳು ಮಾಡಿಬಿಟ್ಲು. ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಅವನು ತಪ್ಪಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದ, ಹೋಗಲಿ ಏನಾದರೂ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ನಂದು ಕೆಲಸ ಇದು ಮುಗೀತಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಏನು ಬೇಜಾರು ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಆ ಪುಡಿ ಸಾಬುವಿನ ಬೋಳು ತಲೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿದ್ರೆ, ಯಾಕೆಂದರೆ ಆ ಬೋಳು ತಲೆಗೂ ಬಾಬ್ರಿ ಮಸೀದಿಯ ಗುಮ್ಮಟಕ್ಕೂ ಒಂದು ಈಕ್ವೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋತಾನೆ. ಅದನ್ನು ಒಡೆದಿದ್ದರೆ ನಾನು ಕೂಡ ಶಿವಾಜಿ ರಾಣಾ ಪ್ರತಾಪರ ಸಿಂಗರ ಸಾಲಿಗೆ ಸೇರ್ಬೋದಾಗಿತ್ತಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಆದರೆ ಅವನು ತನ್ನ ಅವಕಾಶಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಕಾಯ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾನೆ. ಅವನ ಅವಕಾಶಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಕಾದರೂ ಕೂಡ ಕಥೆ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ, ಬಾಬ್ರಿ ಮಸೀದಿ ಧ್ವಂಸ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಇತಿಹಾಸ ಇವನನ್ನು ನೂಕಿ ಮುಂದುವರೆದ. ಅಂದರೆ ಎರಡೇ ವಾಕ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳೋದಾದರೆ, ಈ ಎರಡು ಕಥೆಗಳ ಮುಖಾಂತರ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ ಏನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಹೇಗೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಅಮಾಯಕ ಹುಡುಗ ಅಥವಾ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಹುಡುಗ ತನಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲದ ಹಾಗೇ ತನ್ನ ಒಂದು ಐಡೆಂಟಿಟಿ ಕ್ರೈಸಿಸ್ಗೋ ಇನ್ಯಾವುದಕ್ಕೋ ಅಥವಾ ತನಗೇನೋ ಸಾಧನೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋ ಭ್ರಮೆನಲ್ಲೋ ಹೇಗೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಅವನು ಈ ಕಮ್ಯುನಲ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸೇಷನ್ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಏಜೆಂಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಾನೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಹೇಳ್ತಾನೆ. ಎರಡನೇ ಕಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದು ಈ ಅಮಾಯಕನ ಕಥೆ ಆದರೆ, ಅಳಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಕಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೌ ಈವನ್ ಸೆನ್ಸಿಟಿವ್ ರೈಟರ್ಸ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಅಫೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್, ಅಫೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ಲಿ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅದು ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಹಾಗೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಈ ಕಾಲದ ಈ ಬೈನರಿಗೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರಲ್ಲ, ಅದರ ಒಂದು ದುರಂತವನ್ನು ಈ ಕಥೆ ಹೇಳುತ್ತೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ನನಗೆ ಆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಉಳಿದ ಬರಹಗಳ ರೀತಿ ಈ ಬರಹಗಳು ಕೂಡ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಯಿತು. ಇನ್ನು ಒಂದೇ ಒಂದು ಪಾಯಿಂಟು, ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಗಮನಿಸಬೇಕಾದ್ದು ಏನಂದರೆ, ಅವ್ರು ಬರೀ ನಾಟಕಗಳು ಮಾತ್ರ ಬರೆದಿಲ್ಲ, ಆಡಾಡಿತ ಆಯುಷ್ಯ ಅನ್ನುವ ಒಂದು ಆತ್ಮ ಕಥೆಯನ್ನು ಬರೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಎರಡು ಪ್ರಬಂಧ ಸಂಕಲನಗಳು ಇದೆ, ಆಗೊಮ್ಮೆ ಈಗೊಮ್ಮೆ ಅಂತ, ಮೆಲುಕು ಅಂತ. ಮರಾಠಿ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಸಮ್ಮೇಳನದ ಉದ್ಘಾಟಕರಾಗಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಸಮ್ಮೇಳನದಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ಥರದ್ದೊಂದು ಸೀನ್ ನಾವು ನಿರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಕೂಡ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ. ಹೊರಲೇಖಕರಿಂದ ಉದ್ಘಾಟನೆ ಮಾಡಿಸೋದು ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ಸಂಪ್ರದಾಯ ಇದೆ. ಕಾರಂತರು ಅನಂತಪೂರ್ತಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಭಾಷಣ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಏನು ಅಂದರೆ, ಒಂದೇ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳೋದು, ನಾವು ಇವತ್ತು ಒಂದು ಆಯ್ಕೆ ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು, ನಾವು ಸೈನಿಕರಾಗಬೇಕೋ ನಾಗರಿಕರಾಗಬೇಕು. ಅದು ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರದಲ್ಲಾಗಿದ್ದು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ವಿವರಣೆ ಬೇಕಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಅವರು ಜಿ ಬಿ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬರೆದಿರೋದು, ಸುಬ್ಬಣ್ಣವ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬರೆದಿರೋದು, ರಾಮಾನುಜನ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಬರೆದಿರೋದು, ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ಹೇಗೆ ಈ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರು ತಮ್ಮ ಬೇರುಗಳನ್ನು ಕನ್ನಡ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿ ಮತ್ತು ಪರಂಪರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರು ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಆ ಅನುಸಂಧಾನದ ಫಲವಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಕೃತಿಗಳನ್ನು ರಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಒಟ್ಟು ಕಾಂಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟಲ್ಲಿ ನನಗೆ ಈ ಕಥೆಗಳು ಬಹಳ
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು. ಯು ವರ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಹೌ ಹಿಸ್ ವರ್ಕ್ಸ್ ವೇರ್ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ವೇರ್ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಟೆದರ್ ಟು ಅ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್, ಟು ಅ ಕಾಂಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್, ಬಿ ಇಟ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಶಾರ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟೋರೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್. ವಿತ್ ರಿಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಟು ದ್ಯಾಟ್, ಹಿಸ್ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಪ್ಲೇ ವಾಸ್ ರಾಕ್ಷಸ ತಂಗಡಿ, ವಿಚ್ ವಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಹಿಸ್ಟಾರಿಕಲ್. And this is my opinion, and I've also heard some others talk about it, that there is some kind of a structural difference between his earlier historicals and Rakshasa Thangadi. For instance, you know, be it Tipu or Tughlaq or even Taledanda, there is the protagonist undergoes a certain kind of internal struggle that makes the subtext rather complex. Whereas Rakshasa Thangadi is one play in which the subtext is a lot more linear. But I also spoke to Professor N.S. Gundur, who teaches in Dhavangere University, and he said he was of this opinion that while his earlier historicals were always tethered to the present in one way or the other, Rakshasa Thangadi was in fact history for history's sake. So these are two opinions that I have heard about it, and I was hoping, you know, I'm hoping Dr. Butt will talk a little bit about Tughlaq, because you've all written about it and you know extensively about it. I'm hoping Prakash will talk about Rakshas Thangdi and how these earlier historicals and this differ structurally.
Thanks, Maitri. Just to step back a bit before coming to talk about Tughlaq, and because the theme suggested for this panel is memories and modernity, the way I understand Karnad's dilemma, I also want to kind of respond to what Professor Ashoka was saying. On the one hand, while we see this what you said as rootedness, a sort of rootedness in the Kannada culture, it also perhaps is true that Karnad throughout struggled a lot to have those roots. It perhaps didn't come very easily to him, in the sense that he wasn't a kind of an organic Kannada writer. He throughout struggled with the idea of being an outsider or being on the periphery, if not an outsider. And this is, I think, not entirely a kind of a plight for him. It was something that he even cultivated, I feel. In the sense that Karnad is an intimate outsider. He cultivated this kind of an ambidexterity, or even perhaps a sort of an ambivalent relation to Kannada. He even says that in one of his interviews, which was carried in Rujuvatu, where Prasanna, Karnad and Anantamurthy were talking. I remember in that, I have very faint memories of it, but in that Prasanna makes this point about Karnad not being a very good user of Kannada and his outsiderness in Kannada culture. And that he's, and Karnad agrees to it and says that, it is also partially out of choice that he doesn't see himself as an integral part of Kannada culture. Now, for me, that is not merely his personal struggle, which it may have been, for various reasons, because he seems to be a person, as many of his writings indicate, a person who has occupied some kind of a border space, like for example, his early childhood was in Sirsi, where he was not a speaker of the local Kannada. His mother tongue was Konkani, but also Marathi, being Saraswat, and his language in which he was perhaps most fluent was English. And like Professor Ashoka said, his aspiration was to become an English poet, a world-renowned English poet, which he doesn't pursue, interestingly. And I think this language choice of writing in Kannada and this whole issue of not being entirely an insider in Kannada is a very interesting situation. And that, I think, informs a lot of his works at a tangle. And that is where I want to look at the issue of memory and modernity. Because I think if we look at the materials of what his plays are about, most of his plays are about historicals and mythologicals and folklore, he deals with this kind of cultural memory. I mean, he kind of uses this cultural memory, which is one of the ways by which he tries to make a claim for the Kannada. And like Sir has pointed out, he makes great effort in engaging in a kind of a dialogue with this culture. But then he doesn't, I think it's also generally talked about in Kannada that Karnad is unlike somebody like Kambar, for example, and many others, Bendre or whoever, who are much more organic when they use this kind of a cultural memory, whereas Karnad's is much more rehearsed, I would feel. And in this respect, I think Karnad's engagement with histories, folklore, and mythology, you know, mythological material, all this alert us to some of the things that he was trying to do, which was not only to write modernist kind of plays. You know, we very often characterize Karnad as a modernist in Kannada theatre, but I think he was a modernist, all right. But he was also engaged in with this modernism in a much more complex manner, I feel. I mean, he wasn't a conventional modernist writer. He was also responding, for example, to Suresh Avasthi's call for, you know, back to the roots kind of a theatre, and I don't know if that has, Professor Ashoka perhaps can comment on that, if that has anything to do with his choice to write in Kannada. I also think that the way in which he takes this, you know, language issue, like early writings, we are told that Kirtanath Kutkoti gave a lot of suggestions in improving his Kannada. He wasn't even very, his writings weren't very fluent either. But both in the use of language and material, he is also, I think, trying to, you know, deviate from the let us say, the international model of modernism. And this we find even in Tughlaq. Just as an example, you know, in Tughlaq, for example, the way he constructs the protagonist, or he uses a kind of a folk figure like Aziz as a kind of a, you know, the opposite of Tughlaq. These are, I think, very interesting ways of bringing in a certain kind of you know, split. Duality and split, oppositional binaries, as sir also pointed out. You know, one of the ways in which I try to understand Karnad is the way he tried to you know, kind of inflect the international model of modernity available to him, for which he had a great affiliation, with a certain kind of difference. It is not merely a kind of nativism, which nobody would even associate with Karnad. He was never a nativist. And his use of the cultural memory was also not a nativist use of cultural memory. It was, I think it has something to do with the way in which he also uses duality.
Prakash, would you like to talk about the structural difference between the earlier historicals and Rakshasa Thangadi?
You know, I'll take this position that I am not a scholar or an academic, I'm a practitioner. And what I'm going to say is from my engagement with his plays as a practitioner, and also because he was a friend with whom I was very often in conflict because of our differences in ideological positions. I need to say that at the outset. I also want to make a small correction. You know, I've been trying to change that, whatever they've written on Wikipedia about me, and it doesn't allow me. After I edit it, it just goes back to what it was. And I tried to cheat it, and I tried to do it in my wife's name. And then I got a message saying, you know, this seems to be a person who knows you, so we won't allow this change. I'm really frustrated by this because, you know, I am no longer associated with Suchitra, and that school doesn't exist. Okay, so I really want to, like, make that clear, you know. So thank you for the completely irrelevant thing, but I needed to say that. See, I have, when he... 2 days before Girish died, I sent him a WhatsApp message saying, you know,
Sir, we had a standing ovation for we did a set of four shows at Bangalore International Center of Boiled Beans and Toast, which is his play on Bangalore. And I said, you know, the actors like it and we are improving every time. This is some 15th or 20th show we are doing. And he had seen the first show, which was a disaster. So he said, you know, what more can one ask for? And then 2 days later, he died. And you know, it was such a shock to us because we were not doing it so well and we learned how to do it well. Now, what was the problem of the play for me? I'll start with Boiled Beans and Toast. See, I was going to play Tirumala Raya in Arjun Sajnani's production of, what is it called in English? Crossing to Talikota, you know, and because of shooting schedules in Bombay, Arjun got nervous and said, I don't want you to play it. But I went for many rehearsals. It was really fraught with complex problems. I'll talk about that too, okay? See, in Boiled Beans on Toast, which is one of his later plays, what happens is, you know, I agree with, T P Ashoka in two ways. First is that it's easy to get fooled by Girish's Westernism, you know, he's a modern playwright. I don't think he's a modern playwright in that sense, in playwriting at least. He looks at dilemmas of ideology, ideological conflict in older texts. So it can be contemporary, but modern has a certain different other sense. But I think Boiled Beans and Toast, like his earlier play Family Albums and all that, is a very much like a modern play. And it's full of contradictions between Girish's ideological positions and how he problematizes it in the play. One of the most interesting things in that is that she's right that Girish actually participates in these protests. That image you have of his carrying lung machine was at our protest, at the steel flyover protest, right? So he volunteered to come because we thought he will not be able to come, but he himself came. He is the one who filed the case against the government when that underpass was being constructed in front of his house. But all the characters in that play, they love Bangalore and they love the new Bangalore. And there is one character who says, this road is so beautiful now because the underpass has come there. She says, right? That Muthu character says. Which is completely different from Girish's own position on it. In a sense, he's mocking himself, you know, when he writes that play. Which is why it was very difficult for us to do it. I mean, if you see that production of the play, we'll keep doing it. You will see that, you know, we play it like a dark comedy. It's funny. Because none of the characters there belong to Bangalore. See, there are two types of people who don't belong to Bangalore. There are people from other parts of Karnataka who come to Bangalore and their native place is somewhere else, you know. They love nothing almost, you know, about the city. But they come there for work and they rush back for Deepavali or Dasara or whatever festivals they have, they go. Some of us are born in Bangalore. We don't understand these people at all. We're very bewildered by them. There's another kind of people who come to Bangalore who come from other cities and they think it is heaven. They, you know, they just love the place and they keep like admiring it. And he captures that in the play. It's an extraordinary thing. So how does he differ in Rakasa Thangadi is the question. If you see all his other plays, of course I'm saying all this, you know, completely open to disputation. I was just telling you, Chandan and Mahesh, see, I'll tell you what happens. You see that pixelated picture, you know, that has been made there. It is so contradictory about what you call about digital art and other art. You know, you have that screen behind and you can get that image in very good resolution on the screen behind. But then it would be really decadent digital art it would be. Just cut and paste it there, it would be really decadent. It's not artistic at all. But had that picture pixelated on that digital image, it would have been a very bad image. But if I put the perfect picture on a flex on this, it would have been very bad art. That it's pixelated here makes it art. That it's perfect there makes it boring. This is what we mean by interpretation, whether it's history or mythology or folk, which is what he grappled with in all his other plays. There was no problem, I feel, there because he was misunderstood. And I'm not sure he didn't enjoy it. Okay? So that was okay. What happens in Rakkasa Thangadi is a bit of a problem. Because he told me, why did I write those three plays? There are three important phases in the history of Karnataka. In the major history of Karnataka as we know it. One is the Vachana Sahitya, Anubhava, Mantapa, aesthetics that came with it. So I've written Thaladanda. Then there is the acme of achievement that is in living memory for us, which was the Mysore Sansthan. Remember, because of the Vijayanagar culture of Suzair Aunty, even a commander in control never declared himself king. Remember, Haider and Tipu never declared themselves kings. They allowed the warriors to have that name. However, they were rendered sterile in administration. But the thing is, and the third great event that I have not mentioned, we should have done before, was the Vijayanagar thing, he says. That's why he wrote it. It's only in Rakkasa Thangadi that it is ideology of the street, that what is said in seminars, in articles he wrote, the left liberal intellectual position that he took, that everyone so admires about him, it's only in that it interferes. In other places it doesn't happen. For instance, in Agnimattu Male, when Indra appears and says, ask for three boons, ask for a boon, he can ask his girlfriend that he loves for her to come back to life, Nithile to come back to life. He doesn't do that. He could ask for rain to come, which saves his community and society, which is a young idealistic person should have done perhaps. Aravasu doesn't do that. He asked for the Brahma Rakshasa to gain moksha. I don't think it's easily understandable at all. But I'm saying, if there is the evidence of God, if Indra can indeed appear and give boons, like Superman, and can change time, maybe you can make that choice. He was very complex in these solutions. I won't go through all the plays because I'll just say, Rakkasa Thangadi, at the beginning, Girish creates a problem. You have a random character who says, our own people are looting the place. Namma jana ne looti maadta idare. Namma jana, our own people are doing, he says. Now the thing is, jana looti maadta idare, you could have said. The public is rioting and looting the street, you could have said. Our own people, okay, you get the audience against it at the outset. Then he makes another problem with it, which he carries it as a burden from Thaladanda. You've quoted that outside, it's interesting. Whoever has done that thing he says, when people of, if you ask a little boy in Kalyan, what is the caste of your, king, he will say, he's a Kshaurika, or he may say something else. But when I look at Bijala, Basavanna, he always looks at me in the eye and I feel like a human being. He says caste is a very major problem, even if he's the emperor. And in Girish Karnad's plays, it's always the person in charge who is conflicted. Basavanna is clear because his ideology, he's got ideology. People of ideology don't have dharma sankata. It's like people who have work. It's Creon who has a problem, right? So Antigone doesn't have the problem. So the thing is, he is very understanding of that. Even in Toghlaq, he is very understanding of that. But in this play, you can't even make out why the war happened. Because Girish is so eager to show that the war was not initiated by the sultans. He's so keen to show that he complicates the play and gets Aliya Ramaraya to say this. He says, I'll be brief in 3-4 sentences. He says, because of my low caste, I'm not king. This is what he suggests. That is totally false. The Vijayanagara dynasty is like four different castes perhaps. Actually, Krishna Devara is a Dakshina Kannada origin person. Like, you know, that family is from there. They're Tuluvas. So it's false. That construction and its aesthetic is false. Why I say the aesthetic is false, quick argument I'll make. When Lankesh wrote, what is that play he wrote on the Delhi? Gunamukha. I argued that the distortion of history is wrong. And you know, many people said, you know, it's artistic license. Artistic license to distort history exists as so long as you don't break the aesthetic of reference. That means, if you can say Rama was a good guy or a bad guy, if you say Ravana was a good guy or a bad guy, it does not matter. It becomes an aesthetic offense if you say Rama was the king of, you know, Lanka. It becomes like crazy then. There's an aesthetic. Why did you even borrow from that material if you're so against it? You know, that's what happens. In that he says, because he has a caste issue that he goes to war. He's 92 or 93 years old at that time. You know, why would he go to war? There is a problem in that play because he likes, this is the first play where he makes an ideological argument so strongly, like in the story he just explained, you know, Alida Mele, where it is okay in a writing like in play, it is a real problem. So I don't know what the Ninasam production is, but I would like to do that play sometime, but I would like to say this and conclude that whoever is doing the play now, you will watch the play, many of you, you will see that it's a hugely problematic play. Whichever way you interpret it, because I think Girish breaks his own personal way of writing in which he sees the problem and puts the conflict in the person of the protagonist who makes difficult decisions. It's full of wit and all that. This play, I think, entirely lacks it.
They're going to stage it here tomorrow, I think, right? So I encourage everyone to watch Rakshas Thangdi tomorrow. We've spoken about his plays so far. Now I would like to talk about his cinema, Amrit Gangar. You have this, you reject the terms avant-garde cinema. Right? At least that's my reading of it. You don't, because it's a military metaphor and it sort of symbolizes destruction, and also experimental cinema, because I mean my reading of it was that it's kind of directionless, meandering, as opposed to something that has a seriousness towards the outcome of it. So you propose the terms cinema of prayoga to replace these two terms. So what is cinema of prayoga, and can you use that lens to read Girish Karnad's films? That's my question.
Yes, I'll come to this cinema prayoga proposition in a while. But first of all, I want to express my gratitude to M.i.l.a.p, Mahe, Professor Namdar, the curator and whole team. For inviting me to this great place of learning, what I call great Vidyanagara Empire, Saraswati Sasana. So I'm grateful to you for this. I'm reminding of a very recent story. I had met the opportunity of meeting Girish Karnadji only twice or thrice, very briefly, once in Pune when he was the director there, and twice in Mumbai, once at Prince Division and once at Sophia College Auditorium. Grand Shyam Babu was there, Govind Nihalani was, but very, very brief. But recent, very strange story happened to me just day before yesterday. And it was a long virtual reality meeting, what you call digital world, story in the digital world. So I have a story. There was a screening of a Gujarati film called Helaro. Just day before yesterday, it was released yesterday, or I think it's released today, yesterday. And the director had invited me to preview show, and there was an event manager, young girl. She had WhatsApped me a message and given me the name of the venue and short address, Juhu Tara, that's all. So I took a tuk-tuk from my place, which is up north. I took a tuk-tuk and then we started. So the title of my story is Meeting Girish Karnad on a Bombay road in a tuk-tuk with a tuk-tuk driver from Banaras. That's the title of my story. And this is both, it's a jugalbandi between analog and the digital. So when we started, the driver asked me, Saab, kuch landmark hai? He didn't know the place there in Juhutara. Because the Juhutara is a huge area and long road. Kuch landmark hai? No, no, landmark to nahi hai. So I started to contact that young lady, event manager. I could not connect with her. Finally, I sent a message which somehow reached her, and she sent me a map, link to the map. Never written to me any landmark before. So that was the digital answer. I could not open it because there was no internet in the tuk-tuk. So that was a big... So this tuk-tuk driver from Banaras, old man, wise, he started then his commentary. Saab, aisa hi hai abhi. Hamare zamane mein pura address dete the hum. Iske mandir ke najik, college ke najik. Hum nahi to poochte the raaste mein, khilone wale ko, kele wale ko. Raaste mein aur jawab milta tha, hum dhoond lete raasta. Abhi ye GPS generation jo hai, wo GPS generation ko sirf map hi maloom hai. Agreed with her, him. So what Dr. Bhatt was saying is there were some converging points of my reflections. So then he started his running commentary. There was cacophony of Bombay traffic, you know, the honking symphony which is there. Amidst that, image of Girish Karnad comes to my mind. That's before my eyes is Girish Karnad coming. And I see him as an analog man, not digital. And this analog man knew the binary of 0 and 1. I think he knew it, binary of 0 and 1. So he knew the digital, but my generation is neither, I think it's 80% is analog and 20% is digital. So unlike many of young students here, completely digital generation. So sometime I teach cinema and my film workshop, I always take a celluloid strip with me. So they haven't seen the celluloid, you know. They have not even touched it. So I take positive, negative, interpositive, all 35 mm, 16 mm, 8 mm, or super 8 mm, and they touch it. This digital age, the greatest loss of our time, I think Dr. Bhatt also referred to it, loss of touch. We don't touch anything. If I make film, I touch the mouse, you know, I don't touch the material. I don't go to a lab and where I make color correction with touching the material. But anyway, this is... he goes on, this Banaras man, his commentary is running. Girish Karnad comes to me, and he comes as analog man to me. He is also a man, a great symbiosis. It's a great combination of Prachin and Arvachin, ancient and the modern. And that comes to my mind, the whole idea of modernity, which he somehow reinvented through Prachin and Arvachin, both. So for me, the modern moment is in a flux, always. Modernity existed 5,000 years ago, as much as now. It's maybe regressive now, more regressive than maybe time before. But this presence of Girish Karnad in Tuk Tuk and the Gujarati film, in between, also made a larger congregation in Tuk Tuk, huh? You are on the move. It's 1 hour almost journey. And I didn't have the landmark. So anyway, this Banaras driver resolved, we will find out. You see, we always find the destination. We went ahead. The Gujarati film is about a drummer, low-caste drummer. So that low-caste Helaro, and is based in Kutch, where I come from originally. And I had written about this story, which happens in the run of Kutch, in a small village, in Speaking Tree column, 20 years back. The same story is there. So this sound comes, sound of drum, of that run of Kutch drummer, and the memory of Chomana Dudi comes to me. B.B. Kanand comes, joins Girish Karnad in that congregation in the tuk-tuk. Folk tale, so Ramanujan comes. The three giants are before me in the tuk-tuk and it's moving in the cacophony, the Bombay traffic sounds. this interesting congregation that happened, and then the memory of Once a Riksha comes to me. 40 years back, when I was running a film club, I was heading a film club called Screen Unit, I had screened this film on celluloid. It's a big screen. You know, the memory always remains of the big screen. I don't think YouTube retains memory. YouTube is a very ephemeral, very evaporates, you know. But that memory, 40 years back, I had screened that film, and there was a person called Sadanand Suvarna in Mumbai. I was in touch with him. He produced Girish Kasarwali's film, Katasradha. So he was in Mumbai. So he always helped us in getting Kannada films. So also Sanskara was screened there, and then this Once a Vruksha. The Once a Vruksha memory comes to me, the whole big screen, and it's granular memory. There's a grain on the screen. We don't get that granular memory. You know, the most important image that I remember, or my generation will remember, is from television. When there was no remote control, you have to go to the television and switch it off. You cannot be in your sofa. So at the end of the program, there was only Doordarshan. The one image that came on the screen of television was that grain. Remember that? It's like desert, you know, flickering particles. I think more flickering than that image is unforgettable. That image we have lost. So that image came to me, along with these three, as memory. And Girish Karnad also talks about television. He came on television, he did television program. But the Once the Riksha memory was very strong in my mind, 40 years long memory. And this man, who 60 years career of his writings, Yayati was written when he was 21, just 21, and then 2019, a whole 60 years of his work. I was quite enlightened by what Prakashi said about his critique of his plays. Maybe I may not be able to say this because I have seen only some of his major plays, not all the plays. And I regret my ignorance of Kannada language. But this memory of Once a Big Sight came through cut. And you know, the most the moment or the privilege that cinema has got is the privilege of the cut, where you cut it. So this cut, if you remember, this film, Once a Vruksha, Katyayani is, you know, the Raja Rao, professor. They have fallen in love. They are under a tree and they make love. They begin to make love, and Katyayani buries her head on his shoulder. So his black hair, the screen is covered, almost the entire screen is covered blackness of her hair. Then what should be the cut? It's amazing, very, very surprising. This is a work of art. What is the function of art? It has to surprise me. It has to create this moment of wonder. It has to have the wonder, the astonishment. At this cut, I was just thinking where he will cut it. Of course, it's not solo film. It's both Karanth and Karnad made this film, their first film, 1971. The cut is of a hand doodling something on the piece of paper. Do you remember that cut? We don't remember many of these form, you know. But cinema prayog focuses on the form, swarupa. Very important that we talk about form and not just caste and anti-caste, Brahminism, but how we made it. And that's important for me. The cut is on the hand, doodling something, lines, and then she comes down. We know that it's Katyayani. She draws a circle and fills it with black ink. So it's a black, complete black circle ink, like Bindi. What she will do next? She picks up the paper and start tearing it up. She tears it up with that black bindi to his size, licks it with his saliva, and pastes it on the center of her forehead. So this Katyayani becomes like Durga, you know, with her. And that's a fantastic moment that Girish Karnad and Karanth Saab gives us through this momentary cut. And that I cannot forget, this cut, Once a Vruksha. Katyayani, as you know, is the sixth day of Navaratri Mahotsav. It's Katyayani's day. where we worship Katyayani. Katyayani's character is there in the story. I read this story in Hindi many years back, the Bhairappa stories, Vansavriksha. But this cut of Vansavriksha comes in the tuk-tuk, when three of us is just before me, and the Banaras driver is still running his commentary, cacophony of the Bombay traffic, and towards Helaru, the Gujarati film. Other thing that comes to my mind about Vansavriksha, the memory, is quite important film to me in the entire oeuvre of Girish Karnad. Both come together again in Godhuli, six or seven years after. Both of them come together and make this film. The other thing that is space. They create volumes of space, you know, because they are from theater, theater being the space art, spatial art. There are many volumes of space that I find in Vansavriksha, and volumes of silence. It's not complete silence, but mutedness. There's music on the soundtrack. And the first few minutes, you get the train. It's a tree and train film, as I see. The anchors are tree and train. The train sequence is almost 3 minutes long. It's quite a long scene in a realistic film. They always, and that's the problem with the new wave realism. You know, realism becomes a problem. But train sequence is cut through her memories of her son, young son, Chini, her father-in-law and all that, previous marriage. 3 minutes goes on, and the way it's grooved, because he is going from her house to Mysore College, where she is going to get employment, and meeting Professor Sadashiv Rao. That up to that moment, that scene is continuous somehow, through very nice editing. She is into the passage of the college, a long passage. The train sequence is a long 3 minute and 1 minute more. There's a 4 minute sequence of that movement image, as Deleuze said. That movement becomes very crucial to me in Vansavriksha. I don't think I have not come across this kind of analysis of the film, formal analysis. So this temporality comes, and that's where I think it comes very close to cinema prayog conscience, Girish Karnad. In this film, particularly Vansavriksha, is very, very interesting to me, even now, 71. That was the time new wave had just happened, and Karnataka was, a whole nation was looking up to Karnataka that time. That is very important era, like we do now for Marathi cinema today, you know. But that time, 69 was 70. 70 was Sansara, where Girish Karnad had acted. So in that image of Girish Karnad, in that tuk-tuk, I had this Pranesacharya of Sanskara to Dinesh of Tarang, Kumar Shani, to Dr. Shenoy of Tiger Jinda Hai. Imagine this, he was merging all this. This is what his persona was to me, and that is modernity to me, how you merge time. And then go one plus one, three, he did that. And that three is, that extra one is element of modernity. That's what I felt. Another aspect of Vansavriksha was meta text and peta text. Peta is a Gujarati word, as Mahesh Bhai would know. Peta is a kind of sub. Meta text and peta text. Peta text is a Gujarati word I'm employing here. Meta text of Vansavriksha is Chandragupta Maurya, Shakespeare, Kalidas. All these references come in. And there is a small reference, I think easily ignorable, is ignored. There is a reference toward the end of the film, the grandfather of Chini asks the little boy, he's upstairs, I think he's found some old remnants or something. And he says, well, have you found Gombila Smriti? Gombila Smriti. And that's extremely crucial, as I find it, extremely crucial to the film. We don't pay attention to this small detail, the peta text. The peta text about Gombila Smruti is referred to in Katyayan Smruti, the text, which is the centuries old text, which Girish Karnad mentions. The Gombila Smruti is about Shraddh and rituals and all that. So it's a small text referred to by Katyayan Smruti. This is Katyayan's daughter is Katyayani. So all these are coming together, you know, and that makes film significant to me as referential thing. And then meta text also include Professor Sadashiv Rao, student is from Sri Lanka, Ceylon. And they also fall in love later, but one late evening, it's dark, they're coming home, and then he speaks about history. How history is written, he questions, he becomes critical of writing of history, Professor Sadashiv Rao. History is not objectively written, history written by foreigners will be more true. I think such statement, which are the statements by Girish Karnad himself, he wrote the dialogues. So this kind of meta text, which you find in Vansavriksha, and this peta, the subtext, I think becomes very important in my memory. And then the tuk-tuk is almost closed, and we are asking someone about that place. It's a small studio where Helaro is being screened. By that time, Katyayani has reached Professor Sadashiv Rao's chamber. So this two parallel stories, my reaching the destination and Katyayani is reaching Professor Sadashiv Rao's chamber through long passage. I found very interesting this whole congregation and my memories and all that. The other the cinema prayog, I will, what I mean by cinema prayog, I will like to read something. I have time? To be just cogent. The Euro-America-centric, as Maitri mentioned, terms such as avant-garde, I don't agree with this term somehow because I find it coming from military avant-garde, the first-rank soldiers. Experimental or underground are inadequate for the full comprehension of the complexities occurring at the radical margins of Indian cinematographic modernity. In their talks or writing, neither Manikal nor Kumar Sahni has used these terms for their works, but reviewers in the media have often called them avant-garde. They call even Amol Palekar avant-garde. You know, it's just throwing words. According to Sahni, the basic contradiction of the cinematographic form arises from its capacity to replace the object of its contemplation with its image. The object of contemplation is replaced by just image. You don't have the contemplation. The commercial cinema has used it to create not only dreams that substitute reality, but its commodity gods known as stars. Even montage has, with the best intentions, led to the necessary juxtaposition of icons. In the book show upstairs, I found very interesting montage, the way the books were arranged, I'll tell you later, which totally replaced reality instead of evoking or analyzing it, thus creating a structure close to myth with all its falsehood. That's why Girish Karnad, I think, stands apart. He didn't indulge in the falsehood of the myth. I think he borrowed myth, he explored myth to open out. It's like, you know, he opened out myths like a flower, like lotus. And at lotus open, the myth also open out. And then the bee inside flies and that buzz. So he's that bee kept buzzing. So all the time we are listening to that bee when I read his play or see some of his films. So that bee is important. That bee is modernity to me. The avant-garde experiments borrowing syntax from the other arts have merely been attempts at achieving a kind of respectability for the cinema. Well-intentioned as these experiments may be, they are a repetition of failures demonstration earlier on in Europe, particularly toward the end of the silent era. But in our country, literariness or painterliness, and surprisingly even theatricality, when compared to the normal orgies of vulgar imagination, still pass for good cinema. And that's what the problem is. It's not in context of Girish Karnad, but in general terms, how we perceive cinema. There's a lot about to talk about, but cinema prayog is basically prayog. What does prayog mean? Prayog is a kind of engine. Prayog is engine which moves motion forward, like pragati. Gati is motion. When I say pragati, is a forward motion. So it's a progressive term. It moves further, one step ahead. So the pra yoga, yoga is a kind of sandhi, bhav sandhi. So yoga is lagna. The bhav sandhi is pushed forward, becomes prayoga. So this imagination of cut or abstraction, so this has different abstraction idea. It's a visionary abstraction. It's not material abstraction or visual. So prayoga considers cinema as temporal medium and not visual medium. If you consider a visual medium, your cut will be different. So this cut of this Katyayani is still not temporal completely. So it's still a visual medium, because Karnad and Karanth, coming from theater, had also this visual aspect in their mind. That's what I think personally. So this is, I think, enough for cinema. You want something else? You can maybe. Yeah, and lastly, this digital age, the younger generation, has a new god. And this god, I've coined this term 10 years back, this new god is Gugleshwara. Gugleshwara is charming god. It relishes bluffing, as Prakash's case. It relishes bluffing, and we accept that bluff. There's new ism come out. I was just seeing Vaishali's, he got the book, no? Vaishnavi's book. It's called Post-Googlism, the book you gave her, Post-Googlism. So this new ism has come, Googlism. So all these kind of things are happening now in a fast pace. There is no sthayi bhav, the tree. So this is what I think we should be exploring further. How to get archiving is the problem that we have to discuss. The younger generation, digital age, archiving is at a great risk. Celluloid life is about 125 years, if properly kept, celluloid. All the films now we see is because it was shot on celluloid, preserved well, archived well, and therefore we are able to see even Lumiere Brothers films made in 1896, now digitized, of course, through the process of digitization. But how will you preserve this? The problem that Girish Karnad conscience is a very broad conscience that will incorporate all this discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All the panelists have been so eloquent that I've almost run out of questions to ask them. I'll ask one last question. This is more of, I would invite your comments on a thought I had. And after that, we'll open it up for question and answer with the audience. In almost all of his plays, there are these dualities that he opens up in the beginning, such as the body-soul duality or the moral, immoral, violence, non-violence, and towards the end, they are completely unsettled. He doesn't provide any easy answers. He opens it up and leaves it there for the public to grapple with and come to terms with on their own. Whereas in his politics, he was very clear. There was no conflict, there was no confusion. He made his statements. And this is something that I have thought about. So when he passed away, there were all sorts of posts and comments on social media by all sorts of people. And a lot of it was quite unpleasant. And I was shocked to see this young man who works as a driver for my parents. He had made a very derisive kind of post on Facebook, and I know for a fact that he has not read a single, or he can't name a single of his plays, let alone read them, but he seems to think that he is an authority on his politics, and he had a position on that, and he went ahead and made a post. So what, I mean, when we talk about, so this, he is using technology, he is using his he has an equality to his opinion, no matter how regressive or ill-informed it was. So what is this modernity that we talk about? Is this, is there a problem in looking at it as some kind of a binary between a regressive past and something of a progressive present or a future? So this is something that I'm grappling with, and I'm hoping, this question is for anyone who's willing to answer this.
See, I was a journalist for a few years in the print media. And I can tell you that we used to write lies consciously sometimes. We were forced to. I was working in Indian Express. I was in Bangalore. Sometimes we'd get posted between different editions, Chennai edition or here. We'd get transferred within the organization. So when you're in Bangalore, whenever the Kaveri dispute came, Indian Express Bangalore edition took Karnataka's side. Consciously, and Indian Express Chennai edition took, you know, Tamil Nadu's side. What happens is, at different points of time, you're predicated to take a side or a position. There's a difference between like body and soul thing, ideology and governance. There's always a problem. What you profess and what you can practice are very conflicted many times, right? So the thing is, are we saying that when history was officially written or the print media carried that editorial, truth was being printed? What has changed is that you're giving access to anybody, educated, non-educated, lying, not lying, to post opinion. That's what technology is doing. The last thing I'll say on this is, supposing there's a very economically brilliant person who is made the finance minister of the country, who's brilliant, who knows how to do, understands everything. If he uses that entire acumen to make money for himself, what is the use of all the knowledge? You know, the thing is, you need to democratize technology. You need to put knowledge, you know, like, you know, out in the sun. And then we will examine. But actually, right now, that description is fine because I think we had a lot of bullshit in the past too. It's just that you were officially endorsing as not bullshit. Doesn't mean it wasn't that. That's all I want to say.
Professor Ashoka, you have a comment on this?
See, this is true of not only Girish Karnad, but his major contemporaries also. ಈಗ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಈಗ ತುಗಲಕ್ ಬರೆಯುವಾಗ ತುಗಲಕ್ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆಗಿದ್ದರೆ ಅಜೀಜ್ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ತಲೆದಂಡದಲ್ಲಂತೂ ಇದು ಭಾಳ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇದೆ ಡ್ಯುಯಲ್. ಒಂದು ಕಡೆಗೆ ಬಸವಣ್ಣ ಬಿಜ್ಜಳ, ಆದರೆ ಬಸವಣ್ಣನಿಗೆ ಜಯದೇವ ಅಂತ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಿಜ್ಜಳನಿಗೆ ಸೋವಿದೋವ ಅಂತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಅಂದರೆ ಒಂದೇ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಮಲ್ಟಿಪಲ್ ವ್ಯೂ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ಸ್, ಮಲ್ಟಿಪಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಗಲ್ಸ್ ತಂದು ಒಂದು ಆ್ಯಂಬಿವೆಲೆನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ಟುಕೊಂಡು ಬರೆಯುವ ಮನಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಟ್ರೂ ಆಫ್ ಅನಂತಮೂರ್ತಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಈಗ ನೀವು ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಾಣೇಶಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಕಡೆ ನಾರಾಯಣಪ್ಪ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಸೂರ್ಯನ ಕುದುರೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹಡೆ ವೆಂಕಟ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅನಂತು ಇದ್ದಾನೆ ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಹಾಂ ಹೌದು. ನೋಡಿ, ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡರ ಆಟೋಬಯೋಗ್ರಫಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಒಂದು ಇದನ್ನು ನೆನಪು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವರ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ ಒಬ್ಬರು ಇವ್ರಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಕಾಗದ ಬರೀತಾರೆ, ನಾನು ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಕ್ರೈಸಿಸ್, ಅವರು ಗೋಮಾಂತಕ ಕ್ರೈಸ್ತರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಪುಸ್ತಕ ಬರೀತಾ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ನನಗೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಹೇಗೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಈ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಡೀಲ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ ರೈಟ್ಸ್ ಎ ಲೆಟರ್. ಏನು ಬರೀತಾರೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ನೋಡು, ನೀನು ನಿನ್ನ ಅಂತರಂಗದ ಸತ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಬದ್ಧಳಾಗಿ ಬರೀಬೇಕೆ ಹೊರತು ಅದು ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲಿ ಕರೆಕ್ಟೋ ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲಿ ಇನ್ಕರೆಕ್ಟೋ, ಈ ಹೀಗೆ ಬರೆದ್ರೆ ಇವರು ಏನಂದ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೋ, ಇನ್ಯಾರೋ ಏನಂದ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೋ ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರೆ ನೀನು ಒಬ್ಬ ಆರ್ ಎಸ್ ಎಸ್ ಪಾಂಪ್ಲೆಟ್ ಹಿಡಿಯೋದಕ್ಕೂ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾಂಪ್ಲೆಟ್ ಹಿಡಿಯೋದಕ್ಕೂ ಯಾವ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸವೂ ಇರಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಬರೀತಾರೆ. ಅನ್ಫಾರ್ಚುನೇಟ್ಲಿ ಏನಾಯಿತು ಅಂದರೆ, ನನ್ನ ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನಲ್ಲಿ ಅದನ್ನು ಹೇಳಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಪಟ್ಟೆ, ಕಳೆದ ಎರಡು ದಶಕಗಳ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಾಲ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಇದು ಅಸಹಿಷ್ಣುತೆಯ ಕಾಲ, ಇದು ಇದು ಬೈನರಿಗಳ ಕಾಲ. ಇದು ಈ ಕಾಲದ ಒತ್ತಡ ಹೇಗಿದೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ, ಆ ಇರಾನ್ ವಾರ್ ಆದಾಗ ಅಮೆರಿಕನ್ ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ ಒಂದು ಚಾಲೆಂಜ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾನೆ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿಗೆ, ಏನು ಸಿ ಐದರ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ವಿತ್ ಸದ್ದಾಮ್ ಹುಸೇನ್ ಆರ್ ಮೀ, ನಾವೇನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು? ಈ ಎರಡು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ ಪೊಸಿಷನ್ಗಳ ನಡುವೆ ಇರುವ ವಿಶಾಲವಾದ ಅವಕಾಶದಲ್ಲಿರೋರು ನಾವೇನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು? ಆ ಥರದ ಒಂದು ಚಾಲೆಂಜು ಇವತ್ತು ಭಾರತದ ಲೇಖಕರ ಮೇಲೆ, ಆರ್ಟಿಸ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗ್ತಾಯಿದೆ. ದುರಂತ ಏನು ಅಂದರೆ, ಈ ಕಾಲ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡನ್ನ ಅನಂತಮೂರ್ತಿ ಭೈರಪ್ಪ ಇಂಥ ಮೇಜರ್ ರೈಟರ್ಸ್ನೂ ಬಲಿ ತೊಗೊಂಡ್ಬಿಡ್ತು ಅಲ್ವಾ. ಈಗ ಅವರು ಟಿಪ್ಪು ಸುಲ್ತಾನ್ ನಾಟಕ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಯಾರ್ದು ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ರದ್ದು. ಆ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸಿಟಿ ಎಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಯಿತು ಅಲ್ವಾ? ರಕ್ಕಸತ್ತಂಗಡಿ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನೀವು ಹೇಳಿದ ನಿಜ. See, his admirers are excited about his left liberal image. But at what cost? Karnataka art destroy agutha alva. Idu yaro bhairap noru grohabanga parva itharad mandra itharad kadambrigalannu barthoru konege kavulu avaranad anta baribeku. Because neevu yenagutha nam kala push maartta idenu illa neenu aa kade giru neenu ee kade giru adrinda ಟಿಪ್ಪು ಸುಲ್ತಾನ್ ಆಗಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ರಕ್ಕಸತ್ ಅಂಗಡಿ ಆಗಲಿ ನೀವು ಹೇಳಿದ ಈ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ಗೆ ಸಿಕ್ಕಾಕೊಡುತ್ತೆ. ಸಿ, ಐ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಸಮ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಕಾನ್ವರ್ಸೇಷನ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿಸ್. ಎರಡು ಇದನ್ನು ಕೇಳಿದೆ, ನನ್ನ ಅತೃಪ್ತಿ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ. ಒಂದು ಏನೋ, ಆಗ ಅವರು ಪಿ ವಿ ನರಸಿಂಹರಾವ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು ಭಾಳ ಒಂದು ಇದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಪ್ರಬಂಧ ಕೂಡ ಬರೆದಿದೆ. ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದೆ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಡಿಸಪಾಯಿಂಟೆಡ್ ಇವು ಎರಡರಲ್ಲಿ. ಸಿ ನೀವು ತುಗ್ಲಕ್ಕನ್ನು ಚಿತ್ರಿಸೋರು ನರಸಿಂಹರಾವ್ನ ಇಷ್ಟು ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿಫೈ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಹೇಗೆ? ಸಿ ನರಸಿಂಹರಾವ್ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸೌತ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಟು ಬಿಕಮ್ ಪ್ರೈಮ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್. ನೆಹರು ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿಯಿಂದ ಆಚೆ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಆದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಕಾಂಗ್ರೆಸ್ ಮನ್. ಮೆಜಾರಿಟಿ ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ಯಾವ್ಯಾವುದೋ ಥರದಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಜತಂತ್ರಗಳನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡಿ 5 ವರ್ಷ ರಾಜ್ಯಭಾರ ಮಾಡಿದ ಮನುಷ್ಯ. ನೀವು ಹೆಂಗೆ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟ್ರೋಕ್ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಏನೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಾಬರಿ ಮಸೀದಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾಗ ಇವರು ಪೂಜೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಕೂತಿದ್ರು ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದೇ ಕಾರಣಕ್ಕೆ ನೀನು ಆ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟಿನ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಡಿನೈ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ? ಅದು ಒಂದು. ಟಿಪ್ಪು ಸುಲ್ತಾನ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆನು ಹೋಗಿ, ಏನಾಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಈಗ? ಇಲ್ಲ ನೀವು ಟಿಪ್ಪು ಜಯಂತಿ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಇಲ್ಲ ಜಯಂತಿ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಹಾಂ, ಹೌದಾ? ಈ ಥರದ ಕಾಲ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ. ಇದು ಏನು ಅಂದರೆ ಇಂಥ ಸೆನ್ಸಿಟಿವ್ ರೈಟರ್ಸ್ನೂ ಈ ರೀತಿ ಅಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ ಈ ಕಾಲ, ಇದು ಬಹಳ ಇದಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್.
ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಫಾರ್ ಅ ಕ್ವಿಕ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ಸೆಷನ್. ಐ ಓಪನ್ ಇಟ್ ಅಪ್ ಟು ದ ಆಡಿಯನ್ಸ್. ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎನಿ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್?
ಹಲೋ ಸರ್, ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್ ಟು ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್. ಐ ಡೋಂಟ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಟು ವಾಟ್ ಯು ಆಲ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಅಬೌಟ್, ಬಟ್ ದೆನ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ ಟು ಪ್ರಕಾಶ್ ವಿಡ್ವಾನಿ ಸರ್. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಅ ಬಿಗ್ ಫ್ಯಾನ್ ಆಫ್ ಯೋರ್ಸ್. ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸೀನ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮೂವೀಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಏರ್ ಲಿಫ್ಟ್ and all. I wanted to do theater, like Hindi theater, as in, and I want to ask you how hard it is to be as an actor on stage. Like, what do you have faced in your life to be an actor?
No, that'll be very long. Actually, I had a very good time doing it. But see, I want to say something. I just said to a musician, to Nihal, speaking earlier. Now, he's a professional musician. He does music for TV commercials, he told me. But he's passionate about music. How can he be a musician if he's not doing music all the time, I said. He said, no, I do it all the time. You know, that's what he said. Now, you look at, say, Ashok. If he's going to be commissioned always to write on Girish Karnad's plays or Kannada literature or world literature, he'll never be a writer if he's going to wait for that. He has an urge to write, so he should write. That's what theater provides you. You don't have to wait for somebody to actually produce a play or set up a production company. You don't have to wait. So few of us can get together and do theater all the time. It requires essentially a space to perform which can contain both performer and spectator. That's all it requires. And you can do a play. That is why theater is the only free performing medium left in the universe. Everything else is commissioned work. So that is the answer. It's very easy to do it. If you want to get right to me, I'll tell you how to set up a group. Very easy.
Thank you so much, sir.
Maitri, just one dalle adan helvaga marthibittena na helidnala. I had some interesting conversations with Karnad. Ee prashnan kelide na ಕೇಳಿದಾಗ ಅವರು ಭಾಳ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಟ್ಟರು. ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು ನೀವು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇರೋದು ಭಾಳ ಕರೆಕ್ಟಾಗಿದೆ. ಯಾಕೆಂದರೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ರೈಟರು ತಾನು ಬರವಣಿಗೆ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮೊದಲೇ ಒಂದು ನಿಲುವು ತೊಗೊಂಡು ಬರೋದ್ರೆ ಅಲ್ವಾ, ಆ ನಿಲುವಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದ ಸಾಕ್ಷಿಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾತ್ರ ಕೊಡ್ತಾನೆ, ಅದು ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದು ಹೆಂಗಾಗತ್ತೆ? ಬಟ್ ಈ ಕಾಲ ಹೇಗಿದೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಒತ್ತಡ ಇದೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ಎ ಪೊಸಿಷನ್. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಹೀಗಾಯಿತು ಅನ್ನೋದು. ಅಂದರೆ ನಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅವೇರ್ ಆಫ್ ಏನೋ ದಿ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಇನ್ವಾಲ್ವ್ಡ್. ಅದು ಏನೋ ಅವರ ಒಟ್ಟು ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟಿವ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸ್ಸಲ್ಲೇ ಇದು ಅಂತಲ್ಲ, ಬಟ್ ಏನು ಅಂದರೆ ಅದು ಆಗಲ್ಲ. ಅದು ಕಾಲದ ಒತ್ತಡ ಹೇಗಿರುತ್ತೆ?
ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಸೇ ದಿಸ್ ಟು ಅಶೋಕ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಟು ನೋ ದಿಸ್. ಸಿ, ಹೀ ರೋಟ್ ಟು ಮೀ ಒನ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಆಫ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಈ ವಾಸ್ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಟು. ಹೀ ರೋಟ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್, ಯು ನೋ, ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಶುಡ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ನರೇಂದ್ರ ಮೋದಿ. ವೈ ಆರ್ ಯು ಸಾಫ್ಟ್ ಟುವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಹಿಮ್? ಹೀ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಮೀ. And then he quoted this from Bali. Neevu Yashodhara charitra helidralla. See, adu hittina hunja adara kutigeyanna kuyidaga adu ko anta kugadu rakta chimmadu iruttalla andmele yen artha adike baruthe adike Narayan Murthy galu avaru idra group alli avaru helidru, Girish, you are right, the thought of violence is as bad as violence, he said. I disagree. Thought occurs to a person. You can judge a person only on what he does. You can't judge a person what thought comes to him, I said. And when this happened,
the person who was least violent in response, who later was not nishtura kattkondirodu nimna maatadsala antirodu, the only person I know through all this who remained exactly how he was with you before and after was Girish Karnad. He was not judgmental, he was rational. You see, that was the big difference. And I feel nobody understood. There's another thing about him I'll tell you, which is fundamental to his character, and it's there in all his plays, which is that he was entirely unsentimental. He had no respect for sentimentality, you know. You know, or when he went, see with what dignity he went, you know.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Autobiography, ಒಂದು ವಾಕ್ಯ ಬರೀತಾರೆ ಅವರು, ನನಗೆ ನೆನಪುಗಳನ್ನು ನೇವರಿಸುವುದರಲ್ಲಿ ಆಸಕ್ತಿ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಎ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್. ಅದು ನೋಡಿ, ಅಂದರೆ ಅದು ಅದು ಇಡೀ ಆಟೋಬಯೋಗ್ರಫಿಯ ಸ್ವರೂಪನ
ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. Now the problem is that in the, I missed Professor Ashoka's talk because I can't understand Kannada all that well. Now the problem is, it is not the do you see that as the problem of the artist or the writer? That itself is a modernist position, that to the, it is the artist who is going to provide us a way out. This is the position Anantamurthy also used to take. But is it the much deeper problem that we ourselves, all postcolonials, but in particular in the Indian context, we are facing? It is not the writer's problem, it is everybody's problem. But if we were good in thematizing the problem in the writer, what is the position that we would take? The panel did not reflect on that. I think Maitreyi was trying to kind of provoke you to talk about that, but that doesn't come out, excepting in, I think, Prakash, it comes out very vividly in terms of the critical position that he takes, and wonderful presentation it comes, but it's difficult to grapple with the layered presentation that you have made. But I thought that the two other panelists, if they can throw some light on this, that, and Prakash also probably, that what we are suggesting is that we are very good in thematizing the problem among the writers, and we are also saying that the onus right on the onus rests on the writers to show us a way out. Why is it, where are we in that kind of description? We are taking unwittingly a modernist position, I thought. He's taking that position.
I would like to just intervene first and say, actually, Ashoka's was quite intense about the dilemma that writers face. And, you know, he was quite intense, and I don't know whether he was clear about the position he personally would take, if that's what you want, you know, I don't know. But he was quite intense. So I'm going to request him. ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಭೆಯ ಅನುಮತಿ ಕೋರಿ ಅವರು ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದ್ಸತಿ ಅದನ್ನು ಸಂಕ್ಷಿಪ್ತವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದು ಅಂತ.
ನೋಡೋಣ. ವಾಟ್ ಐ ವಾಸ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ವಾಸ್, ಸೀ ನಾ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್, ಸೀ ದೇರ್ ಐ ಮೀನ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ ಎ ಸರ್ಟನ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟಿವ್ ಆಂಬಿವಲೆನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಕಾರ್ನಾಡ್ಸ್ ಪೊಸಿಷನ್. ಹೀ ಡಸಂಟ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಸೈಡ್ಸ್, ಹೀ ಡಸಂಟ್ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿಫೈ situations or characters. But in the last 20 years, he has become a victim of his times, the times of intolerance. And our time has pushed him to take a certain stand, and his writings reflect that stand. So there is no creativity there. And that's why the structure has become very simplistic, linear. That's what I was trying to say.
I think we've run out of time, so we can't take any more questions. Would you have does anyone have any closing comments? Yeah?
Since Venkat asked for personal,
yeah,
response,
please do.
The way I approach Karnad, in fact, in the very choices that we make of who we read and who we like and who we engage for a long time, I think these also reveal what kind of positions we take. Stating that, what I want to indicate is this, that as Professor Ashok very clearly has put it, the Karnad of the past, where he was able to philosophically engage with all these, you know, divisions, all these incompletenesses, all these binaries, is a much more interesting one, because all of us also have those incompleteness, and all of us also occupy these, you know, kind of border spaces. And I think we are kind of dialoguing with that when we read a writer like, and that happens with me also, you know, there are multiple languages and multiple you know, experiences, multiple social realities of which I'm a part, and nothing can be you know, disowned as such. And you know, I think Karnad himself says this somewhere, you know, the if I remember the expression correctly, the terror of faith, you know, and that was long ago, and that expression, that phrase was used by him of dealing with this terror of faith. And I think today, as Sir has pointed out, you know, it is true that it is not possible to perhaps, you know, as he explicitly mentioned, to examine this terror of faith, where you yourself have to kind of, you know, articulate your faith in a either or kind of a position. That I think is unfortunate for a writer to be in.
See, one last comment, if I'm allowed. See, what happens on social media, that rubbish that comes out there, those rants and outpourings, the trolling that happens there, is actually a struggle to find that middle space. You know, because you must also see it as that, because people don't know how to take, when the binaries are so strong, both sides look like lying sides. What happens is you need to take a position, and we must struggle to expand that middle ground, and technology gives us that opportunity to find middle ground.
Okay, and last remark, please.
No, that's not. I'll make a big difference.
Sir.
One Marathi Sahitya Sammelan, the Udgatna Bhashana, one Kirtarla, now Sainik Ragbeko, Nagarik Ragbeko. ಕಾರಣ ಇವರು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಕೊನೆ ದಿನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸೈನಿಕರಾಗಿಬಿಟ್ಟರು.
ಯು ನೋ, ಹಿ ಟುಕ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ರಿಯಲ್ ಲೈಫ್, ಹಿ ಟುಕ್ ಪೊಸಿಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಫನ್. ಹಿ ರಿಸೈನ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿ ಎಫ್ ಟಿ ಐ ಪುಣೆ ವೆನ್ ಇಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ವಾಸ್ ಇಂಪೋಸ್ಡ್. ವೆನ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಇನ್ ಸಂಗೀತ ನಾಟಕ ಅಕಾದಮಿ ಚೇರ್ಪರ್ಸನ್, ಉತ್ಪಲ್, ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ಉತ್ಪಲ್ ದಾಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇ ವಾಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಕಾಂಗ್ರೆಸ್ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್, ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಟಿ ಕಾಂಗ್ರೆಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇ. ಸೊ ದೇ ವಾಸ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಪೋಸಿಷನ್ ದಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇ ಶುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ದೇರ್. Girish Karnad said, if this play is not there, I will resign. It is because of Utpal Das is a great playwright, thespian, and it has to be there. So he used to take position in his real life often.
It is easier in real life than in
office. Yeah, I think we've come to the end of our discussion. Yeah, a discussion of this kind doesn't have simplistic conclusions. So I think if it is managed to get us to grapple with our own ideas and thoughts about all of these questions, I think it's, as much as maybe having watched one of his plays or having read one of them, I think it's been a largely fruitful discussion. Just at the end, I just want to take us back to this little folk tale that A.K. Ramanujan is supposed to have told Girish Karnad, which he uses in his preface to Nagamandala, about how there is this, so it goes like this, there's this old couple, and the old woman knows this story and a song, but she refuses to tell the story to anybody or sing the song, and they are trapped inside of her, and they want to avenge their imprisonment. So one day when she's taking a nap and she's snoring, and the story and the song come out of her mouth, and they take the shape of this beautiful young woman dressed in a pretty sari. And when the old woman wakes up, she sees this young woman leave her husband's room, and this causes a major fight, and that's how they avenge being imprisoned inside of her. So I think the moral of this tale is very obvious to all of us. Girish Karnad has told us his story, he's sung the song, now it's up to us to make sure they're not held back. I thank you all for being here. Thank you.
I would like to thank all the panelists and the moderator, Ms. Maitrey, for their deep reflections on Karnad, his literature, and his numerous contribution to the creative world. On behalf of Mahe and Team Milap, I would like to present a small memento to all our panelists and moderator. We'll conclude the first half of the event. I would request all of you to proceed towards lunch, which has been arranged in the second floor, and we come back at 2 p.m.